So, Peter, let's get into it. I was in Dubai last week at an event for chief information officers for various cities across the world, including Moscow and Amsterdam and Lagos. And I learned an interesting thing, that apparently 80% of the world's population will live in megacities by the end of this century. So we have this kind of very pressing issue around how we're going to solve kind of some fairly sort of significant geographical challenges. I think it'd be a really good place to start for you just to talk a little bit about shared mobility, what it means for customers, and what it means for other stakeholders.
Yeah, well, shared mobility must be a key solution to the question that you've been asked by your CIOs. However, I have to disappoint you, because shared mobility is actually a very old and boring concept, right? So we've been running around doing mass transit, like using shared trains, shared buses, and so on for a long time. So shared mobility actually is nothing new. But here's where the excitement comes in, because we are getting into the age of shared individual mobility, which is a big jump, right? So i.e., customers can do an individual ride by car most likely, maybe also by bike, if you are the sporty guy, without actually having to own the car.
Okay. Yeah?
And that drives huge efficiencies and huge possibilities for everybody involved. Consumers, because they have flexibility in choosing their mode of transportation, in choosing the car that they want to do, in choosing the way they want to use the car. For your megacities in the making, in that they can solve one of the hugest problems, which is A, mass transit is not for everybody. If mass transit would be for everybody, you wouldn't have 2 million people queuing up Brooklyn Bridge every morning, getting into New York, because New York actually has a pretty good public transit system.
Yeah, it does.
And at the same time, we cannot have a gazillion of cars into our cities.
Okay.
Real estate is expensive. You cannot crowd out people with cars.
Okay, well, let's talk about cars a little bit. Pretty much every major automotive company right now is kind of redefining itself, and they're thinking of themselves not necessarily as companies that manufacture automobiles, but they're kind of redefining themselves as mobility providers. So you will work across, you know, you'll buy access, rather than ownership, you'll buy access to the network. Do you think that's actually something that's realistic at the moment? Will people want to pay a subscription to BMW or Volkswagen or whoever in the same way that they might buy a Netflix subscription or an iTunes subscription?
Well, it might be a possibility, right? I think the customer, we are getting into a world of mobility as a service. Like Sixt, we, for example, have a new mobility as a service product out there where we actually give a budget for certain persons. Boston Consulting Group is a good example, one of our first customers on this one. So the people get a budget for 6 products and they can spend it on car rental, car sharing, i.e. Drive Now, on our own ride-hailing provider, MyDriver. And so it's complete free reign. It's an ABO model, right?
Okay.
So you get a certain amount of budget per month and then you freely choose what you want to do. Now, when it comes to the question of who is going to provide this service?
Yep.
Yeah. Maybe taking one step back beforehand. The good news is that we at Sixt, we don't see the OEMs facing a significant crisis in their ability to sell cars. Yeah? And here's the point, right? With sharing the asset, it does mean that fewer people will buy the car. But as the asset is used more frequently, yeah, there's going to be a higher frequency in having to rebuy the car. I'll give you a simple example. Yeah? So the useful economic life of a car might be 200,000 kilometers drive. Yeah? At the moment, and that's the big advantage of sharing, the utilization of our cars are 4%. Yeah? And those 4% then in tendency lead to cars being run 10,000 kilometers a year. That means that the car will survive for 20 years before it breaks down completely.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Now, that means that this guy will buy a car every 20 years, yeah? Not talking about reselling and so on. Now, if you have car sharing, yeah? If you have those mobility as a service propositions, yeah? The utilization of the car might probably go to 20%. Yeah? But that means that you drive 50,000 kilometers per year with this car. That means that at the same point, your useful economic life goes from 20 years to 4 years. So while there are going to be less people most likely to buy a car, or less cars to be being sold to fleets and so on, there's going to be more frequent repurchasing by these people.
So at the moment, we've got 4%, you're saying, in terms of the life of a vehicle. What are going to be the big socio-economic trends that are going to move the dial on this? What's going to actually drive that 4% up to 20 or 25 or even higher?
Well, you actually already mentioned one key thing, which is urbanization. Yeah? So as urbanities become denser and bigger and denser, there's, on the one hand, there's a better possibility to yield supply of those sharing services, right? The more denser, the better your utilization as a service provider can be for a car sitting at a respective spot.
Okay.
Yeah? On the same time, there's increased need for this. The costs of ownership, the cost of owning a car, are becoming ever prohibitively high. And the main topic here is parking. I mean, like, I'm living in Munich, and I'm actually not living in the city center, but every night when I come home, I face a huge hassle trying to locate parking. Yeah? And that's one thing. And the final thing is that with real estate prices going up in the urbanization, there's less money available to spend on the mobility asset.
Right. Yeah?
So people will face more economic trade-offs and most likely will, in more tendency, go toward the shared model instead of just owning the car for themselves.
Well, you raised the issue of real estate prices being high. That's something that affects particularly kind of younger people. Millennials find it very hard comparatively compared to boomers or Gen X to purchase real estate. Do you see sort of a difference in those customers in the way that they want to access mobility, the way they want to access sort of, you know, your services?
Yes, I absolutely think so. When I look at my customer groups in our car rental segment, those people are typically 30 to 49 years old. That's like the average dude. They are well off. They're economically well off. They travel for business. They travel for leisure. And when you then look at the population of our DriveNow customers, this is significantly younger. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And there's multiple reasons for that. So, A, it's money. It's different use cases that are solved by different propositions to the market. B, the younger people, like the millennials that you or how you call them, they are used to two things. A, they are used to getting everything at the spot from their couch.
Yep. Yeah.
So a millennial doesn't expect to go to a Sixt branch to get a car and then take it someplace. He expects the possibility to take out the Sixt app or the DriveNow app, specify the car, and sort of like walk there for 50 meters or even have it delivered.
Sure.
Because that's the style of living.
Sure. Yeah? Well, we haven't talked really, it is a digital conference, we haven't talked really a great deal about sort of technology and how that's affecting mobility. Do you think that effectively mobility is being kind of platformized in the way that other services are now all on a platform of some description?
Well, it is, and then it is not, in a sense. Yeah? So, on the one hand, what we are going to build at the moment is we are platformizing ourselves, like putting together all our services, ride-hailing, car sharing, car rental, in one platform. So we have a platform which allows for mobility from 1 minute self-driving to 6 months driving, being driven with the MyDriver model. So that's what we call a branded platform. So it's captive, yeah, with the possibility to add on.
Yep.
Yeah. In general, yes, it's obviously easier. Transaction and search costs for customers go down the more centralized the route to market is. Like if you have one platform where you can source everything, obviously there's less search, less transaction, less hassle involved. However, we actually don't want to be platformized completely as a commodity, and I think there's ways out of this for the mobility industry.
Yeah? Okay.
And the major topic is you can't have yourself commoditized. The way you can do this is offering special service, special brand, special characteristics that, and then not go into the big platform, like the aggregator platforms that already are present in car rental, attracting enough demand for your branded proposition.
Okay, so all these changes are going on. What's the economic model? Like, what are the business models that you're kind of really thinking about when it comes to the shared mobility space? How is it possible to, you know, I know the margins in mobility are not enormous. How can you sort of squeeze revenue out of this?
Margin is the main point, yeah.
Okay.
So, well, as I stated, the way we propose to the market is that we offer premium mobility. And this doesn't matter whether it's car rental or it's car sharing or it's ride hailing, right? So we ensure the way we set up the business that we have way stronger than average market quality, way stronger than market availability. We partner with OEMs, we partner with specific OEMs. We ensure that the asset that you can actually get for mobility is high level and it's pitch perfect and it's delivered to you in pitch perfect service. Yeah? That's the common ground. No matter the respective business segment in mobility we're talking about. I think Bill, the professor from MIT, stated something really important today, is when you look at like what drives the success of a business or an entrepreneurship, it's that much is the idea, so like the top level business model, but execution, understanding your market, understanding your go-to-market, and building a team by a culture of performance and service is what really makes you successful at the long run.
Okay. Yeah. Well, if we're talking about kind of these large mega cities and transport systems, mobility within them, how do you think individual kind of personal mobility is going to integrate with large scale transport infrastructure? You mentioned kind of, you know, the New York sort of subway system, got a great subway system here in Berlin. How are those two things going to integrate? Or do you not see them, or do you not see a distinction between those things? Are they going to increasingly be part of like an ecosystem?
Yeah. Well, I mean, like you probably have to differentiate the market segments to understand like how these things integrate or not. So the mass transit, ride hailing, car sharing, car rental, they serve completely different needs. So from an A to B route, just for like a specific route, I think integration is let's say overestimated. It's not as big as one could see at first sight. Yeah. So mass transit obviously is the super cheap way to go from A to B. Mm-hmm. Yeah. With hassle, with other people, without being able to pick your spot. Yeah. Now, car rental actually per minute is the next cheapest model. If you go on a by-minute level, car rental is 8 cents plus fuel considerations, ending up for you at 15 to 7 cents for minute of mobility. Car sharing comes at 30 cents, and then the ride hailers like Uber, we are talking about €1 or €3 per minute. So that means that these models all target completely different customer groups for respective different use cases. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So typically, we don't expect an integration route by route in the sense that you take a Uber to get to the hub, to the train station, then take an underground station to another place, and then take a car sharer to another point. We don't see this being the typical use case.
Okay. Yeah?
Might be a suburban use case, but it's not a general big municipality use case to us.
Okay, so this is a complex, fast-moving marketplace. What do you think Sixt is going to have to do as a company to stay ahead of the trends, to stay, you know, to really kind of win in this space? What are the challenges?
Well, the challenges are clear, right? With the advent of platforms, with the advent of digital technology, allowing platforms not only to be an efficient route to market, but also enabling their atomistic suppliers, like Uber, in delivering the service better, competition becomes tougher. Yeah? We are, at the moment, as I talked about this briefly before, we are investing a large three-digit euro million sum in developing our one platform, which is going to be a complete platform which binds together our car sharing, our car rental, our ride-hailing business, yeah? Both in go-to-market, but also in the systems behind this. Yeah? The winning success formula for us doesn't really Doesn't really change significantly, though. Yeah? When you look at mobility service providers, yeah, the main difference between them at first sight is like how they interact with the customer, right? So it's the customer in car rental needs to go to a branch, the car, and then he books beforehand. The car sharing guy gets to the city and opens via app and so on. But this is not what is really driving the execution of the business. What's driving the execution of the business in the back end is the fleet management, the yield management, getting your pricing right, getting your fleet allocation right, being strong on costs and repair, maintenance, and so on. And these things will not differ. Okay. Yeah? So we are investing a lot in continuing to optimize our core competencies in actually delivering the product at the best price with the lowest cost, with the best availability. And this backbone is not, those backbone which actually drives profitability and mobility is not changing. Yeah? It's ever improving. Yeah? We are also getting more involved in using big data, starting with some AI exercises in optimizing our yield management fleet allocation systems. But this is the backbone that many people forget about when they, for example, get carried away with those new peer-to-peer car sharers and so on, is that what they're lacking at the moment, in our point of view, is the back-end technology, the back-end know-how to actually deliver the product efficiently.
Okay, so the meeting I was at last week that I mentioned earlier, there was a lot of talk about sort of how cities are going to be producing these vast amounts of data that we can't possibly process as human beings. We have to use machine learning, the Internet of Things connecting up various aspects of data throughout cities that we're going to be generating. Do you think there's a kind of an opportunity for mobility providers to actually become kind of quite big players within the kind of urban innovation space as well, to do a lot more almost, offer more services than you are at the moment?
Yes, I absolutely think so, right? So if we, like, our end game, yeah, what we want to achieve by some point is we want to have a Sixt car on street every 50 meters, Sixt/DriveNow car every 50 meters in the city, yeah, to optimize availability of mobility. At the same time, these assets then freely move across the city. They can have sensor technology. We can gobble up the data. We can inform the municipalities, like, what are the road issues, where the broken places. We could even use them as surveillance teams, yeah? Ensuring security in the streets. There's many opportunities with operating the automotive asset in a municipality that we can generate data from and then give this to municipalities, which can put this to force.
Okay.
And improve on the infrastructure, improve on the security levels, and so on.
Okay, so final question. We're pretty much out of time. Where do you think this mobility marketplace, this mobility services will be in 5 years? How will Berlin, Munich be different, do you think? What would be, if things progress in the way that you hope they might?
Yeah. Well, it's ongoing. We are seeing more and more, especially younger people, taking a back step in the decision to buy a car or buying a used car. More and more people actually use mobility as a service. They use car sharing. They use mass transit. They use car rental for longer distances, and then don't need the car anymore. I don't think that there's going to be a big disruptive change on this in the next 5 years. It's an ongoing trend. It's not linear growth. It's still escalating and getting faster. But the outlook is continuous growth for a few years, and then when it gets really interesting, this market is when we finally will go to autonomous driving. That's going to be a very, very interesting proposition, especially for the sharing mobility, for the shared mobility, because then all of the issues that you face today with allocating fleet and so on in the car sharing businesses and the car rental businesses collapse, and it becomes very, very easy to offer mobility very cheap.
Great. Well, cheap autonomous vehicles, I don't think anyone will not want that in 5 or 10 years. So keep working hard on it. It'll make us all happy.
We promise.
Okay. Thank you so much, Peter. Cheers.